Now time, therefore it's now time for question period. The Leader of Her Majesty's Loyal Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Yesterday I asked a serious public policy question and the Environment Minister responded by answering and pulling a number out of thin air, out of his hat. The number wasn't real. The number that is real is $1.9 billion. Right. That's the size of the next Liberal slush fund, a fund collected under the guise of fighting climate change. It's disheartening that you would make families and businesses pay so much more for this government's pet projects. Mr. Speaker, I didn't get an answer yesterday. Will the Premier of Ontario, will this government commit to giving every single cent collected back to the families of Ontario, yes or no?
And while the clock is stopped, I'm going to remind all members that I'm the chair. Premier.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And first, I want to begin by wishing everyone a very happy International Women's Day. And, Mr. Speaker, I want to say to the Leader of the Opposition that I think it's terrific that he has now decided that he supports carbon pricing.
About time.
I think that's a very good thing. You know, it speaks to the realization that is across the country and, in fact, around the globe, Mr. Speaker, that climate change is not a distant threat. Climate change is something that we have to deal with right now. And one of the things we have to do, Mr. Speaker, is we have to invest in the technologies. We have to invest in the community to make sure that we reduce our carbon footprint, Mr. Speaker. All the money that comes in through the cap and trade system will be reinvested in green projects, Mr. Speaker, will be reinvested in order to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, create jobs, Mr. Speaker, and grow the economy and help our economy to be that cutting edge.
Thank you. Stop the clock. Can you see it, please? First and foremost, I'm just going to give some advice. Ovation wars that are going on, if they would stop, we'd be able to get to questions. Number two, it's hard for me to decide on who's heckling who when members of the government side that are the Premier's giving the answer, and I'm hearing heckling from that side. And also from the heckling on this side that basically just wants to repeat names over and over again. So let's just calm it down. And that's your last time, and then I'll move into individuals and warnings if I have to. Leader.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. I didn't get an answer on whether it would simply be another Liberal slush fund. So let me say this. Ontario's former Environmental Commissioner, Gord Miller, said, I quote, "Other provinces did the right thing because the provinces also lowered income taxes at the same time." Mr. Miller said, "It's a matter of being fair with the people and making it very visible." He was referring to a revenue-neutral model with full independent oversight. Mr. Speaker, why won't this government do the right thing? Mr. Speaker, why won't this government commit to an open and transparent and visible revenue-neutral model? Will you do that?
Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Minister of the Environment and Climate Change.
Thank you very much, Mr.
Minister.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. As the Premier pointed out,
Member from Leeds Grenville. Carry on.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. As the Premier pointed out, we're very glad on this House that the other side has seen the light and that the Leader of the Opposition has flip-flopped to a more reasonable position on this. Now, Mr. Speaker, the PC leader says he agrees that climate change is a major threat. That was Mr. Brown on August 27, 2015.
Answer.
But when he ran for the leadership, he said he would not bring his plan forward in cap and trade system for a carbon tax.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier. I would appreciate a direct answer rather than government spin, diversion, and misdirection. A 2015 Financial Post article said it was very clear that the revenue-neutral model worked. Revenue neutrality is key. Don't take my word for it. People from all around Ontario have been speaking out. Let me share with you a quote from a notable Ontarian. I have to be a little bit skeptical about the whole scheme, other than it's going to be a lot of new money into government. Who said that? Former Finance Minister Greg Sobera. So, Mr. Speaker, if Greg Sobera sees this as a cash grab, if Greg Sobera sees this as another tool for the government to simply take more from Ontario families, will you admit, Mr. Speaker, will the Premier admit to the province of Ontario this is nothing more than a cash grab that the Liberal Party is doing once again on the backs of Ontario?
You see the face? You see the face? You won't know when I'm going to pounce. Minister.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And then again, the PC leader said that there has to be a price on carbon on March 10th, 2016. But then again, then he ran against the federal plan to cut pollution by putting a price on carbon. Again, it's a flop. And then the PC leader said there was practically universal support in his caucus for carbon pricing, Mr. Speaker. Flipping again. But again, then just last week, my critic said, will you heed the advice of the PC Party of Ontario and commit to not implementing a carbon tax, Mr. Speaker? And then now the PC leader says the majority of his members agree on this just on March 7th, Mr. Speaker. But then the poor leader, president of his party, Mr. Speaker, called the carbon pricing, the Liberal vision of Canada, a Liberal carbon tax on everything on November. Mr. Speaker, this member has taken so many positions daily on this from week to week.
Thank you.
We never know what his position is going to be.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Start the clock. New question, Leader of the Opposition.
Mr. Speaker, a government that can't defend their own plan chooses to attack. Mr. Speaker, since I can't get an answer on revenue neutrality, my question...
Who is the question for?
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the Premier. Since I can't get an answer on revenue neutrality or whether this is simply another Liberal slush fund, let's talk about health care. This budget promised that there would be support for health care. But what we're seeing is the opposite. More cuts, cuts, and cuts.
Order.
The Toronto General and Toronto Western had to cut 51 RN positions. 59 were cut at Mount Sinai. 61 RN positions were lost at St. Joseph's Healthcare Centre in Hamilton. Mr. Speaker, when will this stop? I thought we heard a commitment to healthcare in this budget. Instead, it's more cuts on nurses. When will the government stop cutting nurses in this province?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you, Premier.
Much, Mr. Speaker. So, as the leader of the opposition will know, if he looks closely at the budget, spending for health care will increase by $1 billion.
There you go.
We are very aware. aware, Mr. Speaker, of the importance of continuing to invest in health care. And, Mr. Speaker, specifically on hospitals, we're increasing funding to hospitals by $345 million, Mr. Speaker. So the reality is that funding for health care continues to go up, Mr. Speaker. Additional funding for home and community care, $75 million in community-based hospice and palliative care, Mr. Speaker, $85 million for community health services, Mr. Speaker. So across the sectors within health care, Mr. Speaker, we are continuing to invest. We are continuing to increase budgets, Mr. Speaker,
Answer.
And that means more personnel, more services for people in the province of Ontario.
Mr. Speaker, again to the Premier, this past week in Ottawa, I heard story after story about the impact of the government's cuts to physician services.
Deputy House Leader.
Graduating dermatology residents were forced to relocate. One family doctor was forced to fire two staff, impacting 2,500 patients. Four family doctors had to close their offices one day a week, impacting 5,000 patients. 13 family doctors had to limit their flu shot clinics. That impacted 17,000 patients. Those were just a few stories that I heard in Ottawa this weekend. Mr. Speaker, there is nothing in this budget that is going to help family doctors serve their patients. Will you support Ontario's doctors? Mr. Speaker, will the Premier support Ontario's physicians and support patient care?
Question. Thank you.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we are actually investing in more patient care. The individual decisions of particular practitioners, you know, the member opposite will have to talk to those practitioners, but there is nothing in our government's policy, there is nothing in our investments, Mr. Speaker, that would work.
Member from Renfrew. Premier.
Mr. Speaker, if the Leader of the Opposition is taking a position that somehow we should put all our resources into increasing the compensation for the highest paid physicians
the member
in the
from
country,
Dufferin,
Mr.
Caledon,
Speaker,
second time.
Then I would challenge him to say, in fact, we need to support health care workers across
Leeds
the country.
Grenville,
we need
second
to help
time.
Support personal support workers, Mr. Speaker. We need to make sure that we have the nurses in our hospitals that are necessary. We need to make sure that hospitals have the budgets that they need. That's why
Answer.
Investing $345 million more in hospitals, $1 billion more in health care is exactly what should happen at this juncture, Mr. Speaker.
Mr. Speaker, back to the Premier, and I appreciate the government's talking points, but I am sharing real stories.
Second time.
Real stories of patients that we hear outside of this Queen's Park bubble. Let me share a few more stories. We know that the postpartum depression clinic for mental health at Ontario Shores is only able to open one day a week because of this government's cuts. Cuts are threatening the obstetrics unit at Georgian Bay General Hospital. The government still hasn't committed to hiring a new doctor for obstetrics and gynecology at the unit
Minister
in Leamington.
Of Tourism, Culture,
Mr.
Sport.
Speaker, today is International Women's Day. I have outlined examples of how maternal health are being cutted. Will the government, will the Premier commit to stopping the cuts to maternal health in Ontario?
Well, the Leader of the Official Opposition can try to spin this any way that he wants to. And it's interesting that he brought up the maternal unit, the obstetrics unit at Leamington Hospital, because, in fact, just a couple of weeks ago we announced an additional $1.3 million, which will allow for the hiring of three new obstetricians at Leamington Hospital to make sure that that clinic, that that birthing unit, that obstetrical unit stays open, Mr. Speaker. And I have to give, some credit to the backbencher from Chatham, Kent, Essex, for working cooperatively with me, with the community, with the local leadership, to find a solution that will actually maintain that the ability of women from the Leamington area to deliver in the province. So that's a bad example. It's a good example of how, if we do cooperate,
stop clock. Even if the comments are. Even if the comments are direct to the chair, I am going to ask that any of the gestures to inflame, they come to me. New question. The Leader of the Third Party.
Thank you, Speaker. I want to begin by, on behalf of New Democrats, wishing every woman in this legislative precinct across the OPS, women and girls across Ontario, a happy International Women's Day. On International Women's Day, let's recognize and celebrate the many great accomplishments of Ontario women. Yet we also have to recognize that Ontario has the most expensive childcare in Canada. And my question is to the Premier, Speaker. The 2016-17 budget doesn't do anything for childcare in Ontario. It doesn't add a single dollar for new childcare spaces in the entire province. Just announcements and re-announcements, Speaker. Just last year, the Premier actually campaigned against a $15 per day national childcare program. Can this Premier explain why moms and dads in Ontario are paying the highest childcare costs in Canada, and this budget doesn't add any new funding for childcare spaces?
Mr. Speaker, I just want to acknowledge how important it is when women are at work and need the support of childcare. It's so important that we have those services in place. And Mr. Speaker, everyone in this legislature and families across Ontario know that full-day kindergarten, Mr. Speaker, for every 4- and 5-year-old in this province has changed. It has changed the landscape in terms of early childhood education in the province, Mr. Speaker. And it has changed the dynamics around childcare. There's absolutely no doubt about that. There is a regulation right now that is out for consultation, Mr. Speaker. We continue to put more money into childcare and create more spaces, Mr. Speaker, recognizing that with 4- and 5-year-olds now, and some 3-year-olds, if they have a late birthday, in full-day kindergarten, the kids who are in childcare are of a different age, and we need to adapt to that new reality. We're in a transition on that front, Mr. Speaker.
Well, Speaker, no matter how many times the Liberals say it, full-day kindergarten is not childcare in the province of Ontario. It is not childcare. And it's not just New Democrats saying that this budget fails families and leaves families in the lurch, Speaker. The Coalition for Better Childcare says, quote, families that believed Ontario would prioritize work on a national early learning and childcare plan will be bitterly disappointed by this reversal. Parents across Ontario took the government at its word that it would deliver. Instead, less than a quarter of Ontario children can access regulated childcare spaces, and for another year, parents will have to be paying childcare that they can barely afford or having to put their careers on hold, Speaker. This Premier has already admitted that her budget is full of mistakes.
Question.
Will she admit it was a mistake not to invest in childcare in the province of Ontario?
Mr. Speaker, I know that the Minister of Education is going to want to comment on your last question, Mr. Speaker. But I need to be clear that since 2003, childcare funding in this province has doubled from $532 million to over $1 billion, Mr. Speaker. The number of childcare spaces in Ontario has grown to nearly 351,000, Mr. Speaker. That's an increase of 87% since 2003. And in 2016, we're providing $1.05 billion to 47 municipalities. That's an increase in overall funding, Mr. Speaker, of $16.3 million over last year. The reality is, Mr. Speaker, that thousands of families across this province have the ability now to send their kids to full-day kindergarten. I know perfectly well that full-day kindergarten is not childcare. That's why we continue to invest in childcare in addition to full-day kindergarten. They're two different things.
Thank you. Be seated, please. Be seated, please. Final supplementary.
It's shameful that this Premier, even in her response, tried to muddy the waters around the difference between childcare and all-day learning. It's a disgrace. Every dollar invested in childcare, Speaker, in childcare, brings $1.50 in economic returns. That's because when parents can find affordable childcare, it means more moms and dads, but more often moms, can get back to work. It's a smart investment, Speaker. I would have thought that this Premier would have believed that. It's one of the basics that people expect their government to get right, Speaker. This budget has a lot of re-announcements and even some re-announcements, Speaker, but what it doesn't have is more affordable quality, licensed childcare for moms and dads and their children across Ontario. The Premier has acknowledged she got her budget wrong already, Speaker. Will she fix it and invest in affordable, licensed childcare for families, Speaker?
Minister of Education.
Yes, and I would like to point out that the figures that the Premier just quoted are, in fact, child care figures, quite distinct from full-day kindergarten figures. But in addition to the figures that the Premier has mentioned, which have to do with increasing capital spending and increasing operating spending, we're also increasing the wage subsidy for our workers in licensed child care this year. For our ECEs in licensed child care, our frontline child care workers, the subsidy is going up from $1 an hour to $2 an hour this year in this year's budget. And for people who work in licensed home child care, the subsidy is going up from $10 today to $20 a
day.
That's in this year's budget. In addition, there is additional capital this year for new child care spaces. Over 3 years, we're building 4,000 new child care spaces.
Thank you,
Speaker. My next question is also to the Premier. You know, it's shameful that after 12 years in office, there is still such a patchwork of child care in this province, that there isn't enough licensed, affordable, quality child care for families in Ontario. In Ontario should be able to expect the highest quality in child care, and no parent should have to worry that their kid's safety is being put at risk. Parents across Ontario are worried, Speaker, about the changes to child care regulations that would mean more children with fewer adults. The Coalition for Better Child Care says the Premier's new rules will not improve quality and safety in child care. Martha Finley from the Child Care Resource and Research Unit says, quote, if they bring this in, Ontario will be leading the race to the bottom.
Wow.
Why is this Premier leading the race to the bottom in child care, Speaker?
Thank you, Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, and you know, I very much appreciate the input from advocates like Martha Friendly and the work that they have done for years, Mr. Speaker, to promote early years education. And part of the promotion of early years education, Mr. Speaker, has been to support our government as we implement full-day kindergarten, because that was seen in early years education as a very, very important step forward. And we've taken that step, Mr. Speaker. And what that means is that we have to continue to invest in child care, because, of course, full-day kindergarten is not the same thing as child care, Mr. Speaker. They are different things, and so as we have implemented full-day kindergarten, we have continued to work with the child care sector to transform that sector. The fact is, Mr. Speaker, that it is important that we modernize the child care sector. That's why the regulation is out for consultation, and we appreciate input from everyone who's close to the issue, Mr. Speaker.
Thank you.
Speaker, the Pascal report was a roadmap for better child care and early childhood education, Speaker, but instead of following the roadmap, this Premier has veered off the road. Instead of expanding and making sure we have better integrated child care, we're seeing fragmented care here, Speaker. And moms and dads are struggling to piece together the care that their kids need. Now the government's plan will mean more kids with fewer adults. It's going to mean lower quality child care in Ontario, Speaker. I don't think that's what Mr. Pascal was talking about when he put together his report. The question is a simple one, Speaker, and I haven't heard an answer yet. Why is this Premier leading the race to the bottom on child care?
Minister of Education.
And one of the things that we've been doing actually is taking a bit of advice from Mr. Pascal, which was that we should look at the child care ratio issues, which had been there for about 20 years. We've been working with a committee of advisors, and where we concluded, when we looked at what's happened in that 20 years since we last adjusted the ratios, two significant things. Yes, we did introduce full-day kindergarten, and that means that what parents need for their 4- and 5-year-olds in terms of childcare has changed. so we need to change. The other thing we've discovered is that over the last 20 years, that maternity leave rules have changed. That in fact, with a combination of maternity and paternity leave, most parents are looking for child care at 12 months now because they're returning to work at 12.
Thank you.
We are addressing that.
Thank you. Final supplementary.
Speaker, I have met with parents across Ontario who have seen their municipal child care centres closing. Those were fantastic centres, Speaker, that kids loved and that parents depended on. Now the experts are ringing the alarm bells that the quality of child care in Ontario is going to get even worse. Ontarians know we should be moving forward, Speaker. Parents should be seeing more affordable care, and quality should never be compromised. Will this Premier actually start moving forward and not backward on quality and affordability for child care in the province of Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
Yes, thank you. And what we are actually doing is we're adjusting the ratios so that there will be more spaces available for the 12 to 24-month group, which is where parents are really struggling to enter the system and find spaces. But we're not putting more kids with the still. We're actually doing the opposite. We're decreasing the ratios. So for infants, where in the old 0 to 18-month category used to be 3 to 10, maximum size of 10, we're reducing that so that it'll be 1 to 3, maximum size of 9, and you now have to have 2 ECEs qualified in the room. Similarly with the toddler age group, yes, we're changing the age group to 12 to 24, but we're actually changing the ratio so it's only 1 to 4 and 2 qualified ECEs will have to be in the room. We're actually going to create the opportunity for more spaces per 12 to 24 month old,
Thank
which
you.
Is what parents tell us they need.
Thank you. Your question, the member from Nipissing.
Thank you, and good morning, Speaker. My question is for the Premier. Yesterday, we provided details of the LCBO document that states, and I quote, "The LCBO's main intention is to sell properties." The government's response was nothing short of a Keystone Cops episode.
Wow.
The Premier said, quote, "We're only selling as needed." The finance minister told the media, "We're selling but leasing back." The infrastructure minister said, "We're not selling, full stop." But all three contradict what's in the exact document. Let's face it, Speaker, they got caught
Minister
again.
Minister of Economic Development.
Speaker, this government is in complete disarray. Why should Ontarians trust them to do anything when they can't get their stories straight? My question, Speaker, is this. Which one wants to do the backpedaling today?
Thank you. Premier.
Minister of Finance.
Minister of Finance.
Mr. Speaker, Inspector Clouseau lives in the Legislative Assembly of Ontario. I'll read a response from the LCBO. I think I'll clarify it completely. And I quote, "The LCBO confirms earlier statements today by the Minister Charles Souza," that would be me, Mr. Speaker, "that it has no plans to reduce the size of a 654-store network through the sale of LCBO-owned locations. In fact, it says LCBO is investing in expanding both the size and scope of its retail network to further improve customer service," Mr. Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Back to the Premier. Let me read more from the document that contradicts all the public statements that they made yesterday. These are direct quotes from the document, Speaker. The realtor would, quote, "determine the high..."
Stop talking. Come to order. The member's not helpful at all when I'm trying to defend your own member. Please finish.
Direct quote, Speaker, "determine the highest and best use of the properties, perform credit checks on potential tenants, and coordinate all related activity with the tenant, including move in." Speaker, they can say all they want about their plans now, and we've heard a few versions, as you've seen, but this document proves what they were planning to do, Speaker. Will the Premier admit today that her government got caught again trying to sell LCBO stores to bring one-time cash to make the deficit look smaller in advance of the next election?
Thank you.
Minister of Finance.
Oh, Mr. Speaker, I'm shocked that the member opposite,
member
who prides himself on being a businessman, who takes pride in being a critic of finance, doesn't have a concept or a clue about the way business operates. And that's what this is all about. They're putting an RPO for brokerage services so that we can provide greater efficiencies in the service delivery of all of the real estate transactions, leases, rentals, buy and sell agreements. That is part of normal operations of the LCBO's 654 store network. Yeah, that will continue. An RP is put out there for public use. It's nothing private.
And so did the member from Nipissing. Come to order. Finish.
Keystone Cops, right over there, Mr. Speaker. Thank you very much.
This kind of to and fro that I just heard, because I heard it from the other side, regrettably, when I was ready to admonish one, I have to admonish the other. That's not helpful to the debate. New question. The member from Kitchener-Waterloo.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Finance. Yesterday I was in Kitchener and Brantford listening to seniors who are worried about the Liberals' plan to nearly double the cost of prescription drugs. Most of the seniors I met were women. Many of them dedicated their lives to raising their families, and now they live on very limited fixed incomes. In fact, the median income for single elderly women in Ontario is $4,000 less than it is for male seniors. And the research shows that elderly women also need more prescriptions each year. But the Liberals want to force these elderly women to pay more for every prescription they need, starting this August. Everyone but the Premier can see that it's the wrong thing to do. These women feel vulnerable, but they are more than willing to fight, is what they said to me yesterday. Will the minister admit that the Premier's plan to nearly double the cost of prescriptions won't just hurt seniors, it will discriminate against elderly women
Question.
In the province of Ontario?
Minister of Health, Mr. Speaker.
Minister of Health, Long-Term Care.
That's a good one.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'm actually very pleased to get this question because the very individuals that the member opposite is referencing,
yes.
Single women, the seniors in this province that are having the most difficulty getting by, are precisely those that this budget will help.
That's
by
right.
Bringing 173,000 more of them that currently pay $100 deductible for their drug plan each year, they will pay zero
we're
deductible. So we're saving them a considerable amount of money. But there's more that we're offering to actually acknowledge the difficulty that those poorest seniors that they face. And in fact, this will apply to all our seniors, where previously a pharmacist could bill for a prescription, including the co-payment, on a monthly basis if they chose to do that.
Yeah.
You might get a prescription for 3 months, but they will fill it only for 1 month. So you may be forced to pay 12 times over the course of the year. We're changing that, and I'm happy to talk about that more in the supplementary.
Perfect.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Today is International Women's Day, and the Minister of Finance should actually recognize what higher drug costs will mean for elderly women. Our mothers, our grandmothers, and the older women in our lives live on less money, and they take more medications. An elderly woman living on $20,000 or $30,000 a year is not a rich senior. Already she struggles every month, and she simply cannot afford to pay more. But this Liberal government wants to nearly double the cost of her prescription drugs and force many elderly women to cut back on wherever they can. Yesterday we heard this will impact a food budget for seniors. And on every prescription, just for them to stay healthy. This is a really serious issue, and I don't think that this government is addressing it. You needed to consult before you brought in this change.
Chair, please.
Will the minister admit that the Premier's plan to nearly double the cost of prescriptions will hurt elderly women across the province of Ontario?
Thank you, Minister.
So, Mr. Speaker, a lot of seniors were frustrated. They'd get a prescription for 3 months from their doctor. They'd go to the pharmacist, and the pharmacist would only give them a 1 month supply, but charge them the full co-payment of $6.11. We've already made that change, Mr. Speaker, where pharmacists now can only bill the province on a quarterly basis. So they have, even if they give out the
member asked the question.
There's no incentive to do that anymore, Mr. Speaker. So we've reduced, in many cases, by 75% the cost to a senior or to quite frankly, any individual in this province. But we have the most generous drug program for seniors in the country. In fact, the closest province in terms of out-of-pocket costs for seniors is twice what Ontario is. Ontario's average out-of-pocket cost for seniors is $277 annually. The next closest is $600. And I didn't get a chance to reference some of the provinces, in fact, out east, where PEI, it's $957 each year that a senior is expected to pay out of pocket. We have the most generous program in the whole country. We're going to keep it that
way. Thank you. Another question? The member from Barrie.
Mr. Speaker, my question is for the minister responsible for women's issues. Speaker, today marks the International Women's Day. I'm so proud of my two daughters, Kelly and Stacy, and my beautiful granddaughter, Carling, who is finishing her third year at Queen's University right now. I'm also very proud to be a member of a government that takes women's issues so seriously. The minister responsible for women's issues plays an important role in our cabinet. She brings a gender lens to cabinet decision-making. She has exhibited remarkable leadership in the government's efforts to address gender-based violence and to improve women's economic independence and security. Can the minister please update the House on her progress on these initiatives since the last International Women's Day?
Speaker, I'd like to thank the member from Barrie for this question, and I also want to wish everyone in this legislature a happy International Women's Day. And to everyone in Ontario, we've had a fantastic year, Speaker, at the Ontario Women's Directorate. We've done that work with many government ministries. We introduced our Sexual Violence and Harassment Action Plan to change attitudes, improve supports for survivors who come forward about abuse, and make workplaces and campuses safer. We launched a public education campaign that's reached over 84 million people, and market research shows us this is having a positive impact on people's attitudes. And this legislature has debated the Sexual Violence and Harassment Action Plan legislation, Bill 132, and I'm very excited about this bill being voted on after question period today. And we have a roundtable chaired by two wonderful women here violence against women. Thank you, Speaker.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Mr. Speaker, I'd like to thank the minister for her answer and for her work on the Sexual Violence and Harassment Action Plan. Over the last year, I'd also like to recognize the work of the Violence Against Women Roundtable and its co-chairs since its establishment last March. I know that the minister has also been working with other members of Cabinet on a number of initiatives that will make Ontario a safer and more inclusive province. These collaborations across ministries are important to ensuring that issues that affect women are treated with the seriousness that they deserve, in spite of the heckling across the hall. Can the minister please describe some of her work across government to address these important issues?
Thank you. Minister.
Thank you again to the member from Barrie for the question, and she's absolutely right. We work with many ministries on this important file. To highlight a few, Speaker, we partner with the Ministry of Labour to establish a steering committee to address the persistent and unacceptable issue of the gender wage gap. And we've worked with the Minister of Finance to establish the comply or explain amendments required for TSX-listed companies to report publicly on their approach to increasing the number of women on their boards. And the Women's Directorate is currently co-leading the development of a human trafficking strategy with the Ministry of Community Safety and Correctional Services. And just a few weeks ago, Speaker, I joined with the Minister of Aboriginal Affairs and our Premier to announce the $100 million strategy to end violence against Indigenous women. These partnerships, Speaker, are critical to our success, and we are committed to moving the women's agenda further and stronger so that women will enjoy.
Thank you. New question, the member from Prince Edward Hastings.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question this morning is for the Minister of Education. Speaker, last week I asked the minister if she was prepared to guarantee that Saganaska Demonstration School in Belleville would not close, and the first word out of her mouth was yes. But over the weekend, we heard from union officials that the government is returning teachers currently on secondment to schools like Saganaska back to their home boards for next school season. This after we learned last week that the government had stopped enrollment at the schools for the upcoming school year. Speaker, the minister can't have it both ways. I'll ask the same question I asked last week of the minister. Will she guarantee that she will not close Saganaska Demonstration School in Belleville?
Just say yes.
Yes, thank you, and that's actually not the question you asked last week. What I said last week and what I will repeat today is that it is important to distinguish which schools we are consulting on and which schools we're not consulting on, because there is a great deal of confusion. We are not consulting on the School for the Deaf, Whitney, in Belleville. We are not consulting on the School for the Blind, Speaker, in your hometown of Brampton. We are not consulting on the School for the Deaf, Drury, in Milton. And you asked me last week if Whitney would be staying open, and I said yes, Whitney would. I absolutely guaranteed Whitney would be staying open. We're not even consulting on it. But what I have also said repeatedly is that we are in the process of consulting on the other schools, and no decisions have been made.
Thank you. Supplementary.
And we can rewind the tape, Mr. Speaker. I have it on my YouTube. Clearly, the minister said last week the first word out of her mouth when asked about Saganaska was yes. However, I had the opportunity to visit Saganaska School last week. I met with parents. I met with staff. I met with the students. I met with the teachers. This school is making an incredible difference in our province. Two of the students that I talked to last week, Mr. Speaker, should have been in grade 8 at their home schools, but they have severe learning disabilities. In just a few short months after arriving at Saganaska Demonstration School, these students are now up to their grade level in reading. They're back up to grade 8. Miraculous things actually are happening at these demonstration schools in Ontario. One parent told me, Mr. Speaker, that Saganaska School saved their kids' lives. It was an emotional visit to this demonstration school last week. Because of this Liberal government's inefficiency in managing its dollars, it's putting the school at risk. Will she guarantee Saganaska School will remain?
Thank you. Be seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Thank you very much, Speaker. The member opposite is correct. The programs for very high-need students at the demonstration schools are, in fact, quite wonderful. I agree. I've been visiting the programs as well. They work with children who have severe learning disabilities, who are of average or above average intelligence, and who are many, many grades behind in terms of their ability to read. But there's a limited number of children who have access to those programs. And what we need to think about is all the children in Ontario who are struggling to read. And because we know that the demonstration schools are serving literally 150 of the children in Ontario who struggle to read. We know
Order.
There are thousands more there. And we need
Thank you. Thank you. The member from Prince Edward Hastings will come to order. New question, the member from London West.
Thank you, Speaker. In recognition of International Women's Day, I have a question for the Attorney General. Yesterday, the Attorney General refused to explain why the 2016 funding allocations for partner assault response include a 50% cut to the Windsor PAR program and a 25% cut for Elgin. I'd like to list all the cuts that have been made this year, but have been unable to get that information from her ministry. Why did the minister ignore the advice of virtually everyone who understands what is needed to end violence against women, and instead cut the only government program designed to change the behavior of abusers?
Thank you. General.
So thank you, the member, for this question. As I said yesterday, Mr. Speaker, PAR is a very, very important program. And last year we serve over 11,000 offenders were referred to this program, and we are committed to collaborating with stakeholders on the way to further improve PAR. What I said yesterday is that the PAR program has been increased, and has been our government's annual investment in PAR program has increased by 47% from 7.2 million in 2004 and 5 to 10.6 million in 2015 and 16. So we know that some service provider are concerned about the decline in referral rate and the data the government.
Supplementary.
Thank you, Speaker. A lot has changed over the 12 years that the minister refers to. I understand that there's a meeting coming up on April 20th, a stakeholder meeting. I also understand that not a single representative from the sector has been involved in planning for that meeting, not even the minister's own Partner Assault Response Advisory Committee. Given the minister's actions to date, the comments she has made, there are real concerns about her commitment to meaningful collaboration. Does this minister realize that her refusal to acknowledge the crisis in PAR is putting the safety of women and children at risk? Will she commit to honest dialogue on April 20th and guarantee that the meeting is not just providing lip service to consultation in order to make further cuts to PAR?
Thank you. Attorney General, be seated, please. Thank you, Attorney General.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
Funding allocation, Mr. Chair, are based on referral rate and demand for service in each jurisdiction. So it is readjusted. You know, in some area, if the demand is very low, then the budget is readjusted. But, you know, we have heard a lot of concern about this program, and that's why I have called, you know, a meeting to all our partners to come and tell us, you know, what is not working in the program, and if there is, you know, change to bring about to the program. We are, of course, you know, listening to our partner because they delivered the program, and we are also consulting with experts on the topic of domestic violence, and so we will, I'm sure, come back with an improved program if this actual program will continue. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Question, the member from Mississauga-Streetsville.
Well, thank you, Speaker. This question is for the Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade. Since the first North American free trade agreements were negotiated almost 30 years ago, an export market has become one that you have to cross an ocean to reach. In 2013, Ontario introduced its Going Global strategy to help Ontario companies capitalize on global export trends and needs, compete more effectively, and become more productive. That strategy helped new and existing firms, large and small, to respond to market needs in emerging export markets. Our province has brought together Ontario private sector decision makers and their overseas counterparts during trade missions such as the one in which I joined the minister in India this winter. Speaker, will the minister tell the House how Ontario will pursue international trade opportunities during this year of 2016?
Thank you. Minister of Citizenship, Immigration and International Trade.
Thank you, Speaker, for the opportunity, and also want to thank the member from Mississauga-Streetsville for asking. Speaker, the 2016 budget will affirm this government's commitment to jobs and economic prosperity. I was pleased to say that our budget addresses our need in international trade by dedicating $30 million over the next 3 years. Speaker, this funding will allow us to continue our global trade strategy, plan and execute premier and minister-led trade missions, and continue to connect Ontario businesses with the world. Speaker, it also allows us to host the Europe Global Export Forum in Toronto, The forum enables Ontario small and medium-sized companies to explore new market opportunities in Europe and connect
Answer.
With incoming buyer delegations. Speaker, the 2016 budget will allow us to continue to sell Ontario worldwide.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Minister, Western Mississauga has prospered through the outreach of our firms into high skills and high value agreements with firms outside Canada. One need only look at aerospace manufacturer Cyclone Manufacturing in Meadowvale as an example of a company growing at 20% per year and forging new agreements with European and Asian partners, as well as its aerospace base here in North America. The province's 2016-17 budget built upon the groundwork the province has laid during the past decade to attract international investors to Ontario and to enable Ontario firms to compete overseas. Speaker, will the minister tell the House how the measures proposed in Ontario's 2016-17 budget enhance trade opportunities for
Question.
Ontario exporters, large and small?
Thank you, Minister.
Speaker, I'm very proud of the current budget. Speaker, $10 million this year will allow my ministry to expand our trade opportunities.
Stop the clock. Well, no, actually, keep it going. Just remind the member from Stoney Creek, Hamilton East Stoney Creek, the closer he gets to the chair, the easier it is for me to hear, just to let him know. Minister?
Maybe moving back time. As the member is aware, Speaker, our trade missions provide opportunities for Ontario businesses to connect with relevant investors abroad. Our mission to China in the fall 2014 secured $1 billion in investment, creating 1,400 jobs for Ontarians. Our follow-up mission to China in 2015 resulted in over $2 billion in investment, creating 1,700
Answer.
Jobs. Speaker, our mission to India last month resulted in $240 million investment and created 150 skilled jobs. Thank you, Speaker.
Question, the member from Halliburton, Cortha Lakes, Ross.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is to the Premier. Today is International Women's Day, and while I am proud to say that gender equality has come a long way since the first day of commemoration in 1911, this government has made decisions that have set Ontario back by decades. This government, led by the Premier, have allowed two publicly funded colleges to offer courses at its campuses in Saudi Arabia. But women weren't allowed on those campuses. When asked about it by the media, the Premier denied knowing anything about it. The minister blamed the colleges and then blamed his predecessor. John Molloy said the funding was approved by Cabinet, which the Premier was a member of. Speaker, can the Premier explain why those campuses were funded and why she couldn't get her facts straight?
Question.
Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Minister of Training, Colleges and Universities.
Thanks.
Minister.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, we are very proud of our colleges. Our colleges are among the best in the world. That's why they have been very well sought of around the world. Mr. Speaker, the Saudi government asked actually request for proposals in the world, and our colleges bid on those proposals. Algonquin College bid on two proposals, Mr. Speaker, one for building a college for male and the other one for building a college for females. And their proposal for building a college for male students were successful. They are successfully operating in Saudi Arabia, and their bid for female college wasn't successful, but they are going to bid again on building a college for female students if the proposal comes up from Saudi Arabia. Mr. Speaker, again, we are very proud of our colleges. They are very well thought of around the world, and we will continue our
Answer.
Efforts to support our colleges, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Well, Mr. Speaker, that doesn't make it okay, and the Premier should be answering this question.
Here, here.
Our students, in fact, all Ontarians were shocked and disappointed that this government not only allowed but funded such a blatantly discriminatory practice. Because of a sheer lack of accountability, the government allowed a practice that shames our province and our values of equality and freedom. In this province and across this country, we know that boys and girls equally can achieve their full potential. The Premier has said that the government should be a force for good, yet she has allowed our province's reputation to sink back to the dark ages. Mr. Speaker, why did the Premier allow such discrimination to happen right under her nose?
Okay. You seated, please. You seated, please. Thank you. Minister.
Mr. Speaker, again, we are very proud of our function of our colleges. For example, Mr. Speaker, Niagara College has been active in Saudi Arabia for a number of years, and they have been training actually 120 female professionals to become the medical clinical administrative officers in Saudi Arabia with the assistance of the King Faisal Hospital. So they have been active in Saudi Arabia training male and female students, and we will continue to support our colleges. Mr. Speaker, our colleges are doing a great job. Our colleges are training our students as well as they are offering their services to other countries around the world. Mr. Speaker, since we came to the office, we have increased funding to our colleges and universities by 83%. Per student funding has been increased by 30% for our universities and 35% for our colleges. So we are supporting our colleges, and also we would like our academic institutions to go global. And
thank you. Your question, member from Welland.
Thank you, Speaker. My question is to the Minister of Labour. Women in Ontario are still getting paid less than men. Women are still more likely to work in low-paid jobs and less likely to be promoted. Women are still getting paid less than men for equal work. Nearly 30 years ago, the Ontario government passed pay equity legislation requiring equal pay for work of equal value, but today women are still earning up to 31% less. Worse, racialized women, Indigenous women, and women with disabilities still face a larger gap. Women deserve to see concrete action from this government, and our young women need to feel some hope. On International Women's Day, will this government stand up for women across this province and take immediate action to address the wage gap?
Thank you, Minister Labour.
Thank you, Speaker, and I do want to thank the member for that question. It's an extremely important issue, and it's great to see members from all parties in the legislature today stand and rise and recognize International Women's Day. I think it says something about this chamber. Women make up an integral part of our economy. I think we all agree with that in society, but on average, Speaker, they do not earn as much as men. What we've done about that is I've announced the creation of a wage gap steering committee, Speaker. They've been active for the past year. They've been working along with the minister responsible for women's issues. What they're doing is they're traveling the province. They're receiving advice from ordinary Ontarians and those Ontarians that have expertise in this regard. They'll be reporting back to me with a strategy that's aimed at closing the earning gap between men and women in this province. Speaker, this is an issue whose time has come. We're determined to build on the progress we've already made in this regard.
Thank you. Supplementary.
Speaker, with the right legislation and a real commitment to act, we know that the gender gap could be eliminated. This government talks a lot about the gender wage gap, but we've seen no action. Instead, women in this province continue to fall further and further behind under this Liberal government, a government that refuses to even comply and enforce its own pay equity laws. In many female-dominated workplaces and for professionals in education, health, and many of the community sectors in this province. Minister, it's 2016, nearly 30 years later. How can this government justify allowing the gender wage gap to continue to widen?
Thank you. Minister?
Well, quite frankly, Speaker, the answer is we don't. We don't accept that, and we shouldn't accept that, not one of the parties in this House. We should take pride, Speaker. We're the only jurisdiction that I'm aware of in this country that is tackling this issue head on. that we're taking the issue on. The gender wage gap is a complex issue. It's got many factors that add to it. We've heard from a diverse group of people across this province that share the same feeling as us, that this is unacceptable, that gap needs to be closed, that there shouldn't be a gap in the first place, Speaker. So what this strategy is going to do in a very factual way and in a very practical way is propose recommendations that will close that wage gap, Speaker, that still exists between women and men in this province. You know, the short summary of the answer is, Speaker, we agree with the member and we're doing something about it. We're the only province that is, Speaker.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. My question is for the Minister of Labour. Minister, over the past few weeks, I constantly hear from parties opposite about precarious work. I also hear from my constituents in my riding of Scarborough Agent Court and service agencies like Agent Court Community Services Association about unpaid wages, gender inequality and scheduling conflicts in their workplaces. Speaker, in my recent post-budget roundtable discussion, I heard from young constituents like Elaine, Nancy, Dewan and Kevin. They asked about stronger labour law protection and updating our current labour laws. These young people know our government supports them and has a plan. Speaker, through you to the Minister, can you please update the House about what your ministry is taking to ensure that my constituents and workers across this province are protected and supported at work?
Minister of Labour.
Thank you, Speaker. Once again, I want to thank the member for that excellent question. Precarious work is a very, very important issue, and I'm proud of the early steps we've taken. To add to this, I think, Speaker, our government's tabled a budget in this House that demonstrates our dedication to creating good full-time jobs in this province. At the Minister of Labour, we've got two excellent advisors, Speaker. They've been working all year to ensure that those people that work in the province of Ontario have the right protections in place that reflect the modern economy. What it's called, Speaker, is a changing workplaces review, and what it does is it takes into account that the workplace many of us grew up in simply isn't the workplace of today, and the legislation needs to catch up to that, Speaker. The budget also commits to support, as I said previously, the gender wage gap strategy, because we know a wage gap exists there, and that adds further to precarious employment. We're going out to the public, Speaker, saying this isn't acceptable anymore. What do we need to do to change this? And getting some excellent advice.
Complimentary.
Thank you, Speaker. Thank you to the Minister for that answer. Speaker, I'm very pleased to see that our government supports all workers in Ontario, no matter the type of work, its size or location. Both residents and service agencies in my riding of Scarborough Agent Court are keen to hear from the Minister when he received both the Changing Workplace Review Interim Report and the Gender Wage Gap Committee's recommendations. Until then, can the Minister please outline what the government is doing right now to help Ontario workers not only feel safe at work, but also understand their rights and responsibilities?
Thank you, Minister.
Thank you, Speaker. And again, I'd really like to thank the member for that question. The work being done by the Changing Workplace Special Advisors and the Gender Wage Gap Steering Committee are really just two examples, Speaker, of how the Minister of Labour is making Ontario one of the best places to work and one of the safest places to work in all of North America. Speaker, this government was the first government to proactively go out and inspect workplaces. We feel it's our job to make sure employers play by the rules and that employees know their rights when they go to work. Speaker, these inspections are truly bringing in results. Since 2005, the Ministry of Labour has recovered approximately $141 million in unpaid wages and other money that's owed to employees. We know that educating people, Speaker, we know that bringing awareness plays a huge role in ensuring that Ontario workplaces are not only safe but fair. Speaker, we have a website.
Thank you.
I'd urge people in Ontario to use
it. Thank you. Your question, the member from Renfrew, Nipissing, Pembroke.
My question is to the Minister of Energy. Last month, the government announced that they were creating a $100 million fund so that homeowners using natural gas can more easily receive an energy audit and potential assistance on retrofitting their furnaces. The problem is, and according to the Canadian Propane Association and the Canadian Oil Heat Association, is that people who heat their homes with a propane oil or oil furnace are completely excluded. For many people in northern and rural Ontario, natural gas is simply not available. Speaker, to the minister, Will they clarify? Because I heard from the Deputy Premier today that they're going to make that program available to people who heat with propane or oil. So will the minister clarify today for the people of Ontario? Because they have been misunderstanding. If they're misunderstanding us, let us know. But if it is strictly for natural gas, then fix it and stop attacking people through Ontario.
Mr. Speaker, Union Gas and Enbridge are finding the ways and means to ensure that the other types of fuels will be included in that program, Mr. Speaker. Thank you.
Thank you. Point of order, the member from Ottawa Orléans.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. I just would like to introduce the two of constituents of mine who are here, one in the gallery, Jean Hébert, who is here today, and also a paramedic from Ottawa, Norma Robillard. Welcome to the legislature.
Quickly, Mr. Speaker, Page Captain Mika Joy Taminga, and her is joined today by her grandmother, Catherine McLean, grandfather, Malcolm McLean, grandmother, Jewel House McLean, and sisters, Claire and Morgan, and they're in the gallery today. Welcome.
We have a deferred vote on the motion. Vote on the motion for third reading of Bill 132, an act to amend various statutes with respect to sexual violence, sexual harassment, domestic violence, and related members. Call on the members. This will be a 5-minute bill. All members, please take their seats. All members, please take your seats. On Monday, March 7, 2016, Ms. Charles moved third reading of Bill 132, an act to amend various statutes with respect to sexual violence, sexual harassment, domestic violence, and related matters. All those in favor, please rise one at a time, be recognized by the clerk.
Mr. Charles.
Mr. Charles.
Mr. Matthews.
Mr. Matthews.
Mr. Bradley.
Bradley.
Mr. Shirelli.
Mr. Shirelli.
Madam Mayor.
Madam Mayor.
Mr. Sousa.
Mr. Sousa.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Wynn.
Ms. Matthews.
Ms. Matthews.
Mr. Hoskins.
Mr. Hoskins.
Ms. Sandals.
Ms. Sandals.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Duguid.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Takkar.
Mr. Barnetti.
Mr. Barnetti.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Delaney.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Dillon.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Orzetti.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. Gravel.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. McMeekin.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Murray.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Chan.
Mr. Moriti.
Mr. Moriti.
Mr. Couteau.
Mr. Couteau.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Flynn.
Mr. Zimmer.
Mr. Zimmer.
Madame Lalonde.
Madame Lalonde.
Mr. Quadri.
Mr. Quadri.
Ms. Albanese.
Ms. Albanese.
Mr. Dixon.
Mr. Dixon.
Ms. Manga.
Ms. Manga.
Mr. Crack.
Mr. Crack.
Ms. Hunter.
Ms. Hunter.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Sergio.
Mr. Morrow.
Mr. Morrow.
Ms. Jasek.
Ms. Jasek.
Mr. Del Duca.
Mr. Del Duca.
Ms. Darmala.
Ms. Darmala.
Ms. Wong.
Ms. Wong.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Fraser.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Anderson.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Baker.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Ballard.
Mr. Dong.
Mr. Dong.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Hogarth.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Koala.
Ms. Molly.
Ms. Molly.
Mrs. Martins.
Mrs. Martins.
Ms. McGarry.
Ms. McGarry.
Ms. McMahon.
Ms. McMahon.
Mr. Milchin.
Mr. Milchin.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Ms. Naidu Harris.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Potts.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Mr. Rinaldi.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Verniel.
Ms. Scott.
Ms. Scott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Arnott.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Hardiman.
Mr. Wilson.
Mr. Wilson.
Ms. Jones.
Ms. Jones.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Brown.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Clark.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Fidelli.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Yakubuski.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. Hillier.
Mr. McNaughton.
Mr. McNaughton.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. Thompson.
Ms. DeBarrett.
Mr. Barrett.
Ms. Monroe.
Ms. Monroe.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. Hudak.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. McLaren.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Bailey.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Walker.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Smith.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Harris.
Mr. Nichols.
Mr. Nichols.
Ms. Marteau.
Ms. Marteau.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. McDonnell.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Pettipies.
Mr. Cole.
Mr. Cole.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Sattler.
Ms. Horvath.
Ms. Horvath.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bisson.
Mr. Bantoff.
Mr. Bantoff.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Tabbins.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East, Stony Creek.
Mr. Miller, Hamilton East, Stony Creek.
Mr. Natasha.
Mr. Natasha.
Ms. Armstrong.
Ms. Armstrong.
Madame Jelena.
Madame Jelena.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Fife.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Forster.
Ms. Yermonta.
Ms. Yermonta.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Hatfield.
Mr. Gates.
Mr. Gates.
Ms. French.
Ms. French.
All those opposed, please rise one at a time. Be recognized by the clerk. The ayes being 94 and the nays being 0, I declare the motion carried.
Third reading of the bill, 20 of next year, proposal to law.
Be it resolved that the bill do now pass and be entitled as in the motion. There are no further, there is a point of order from the Minister of Education.
I want to correct my record. I believe that I might have said the school for the blind is in Brampton, and I know perfectly well it is in Brantford.
All members have a right to correct their own record, for sure. There are no deferred votes. This House stands recessed till 3 p.m. this afternoon.